Hello, this is my Twisty Puzzle Chess Set. All 32 pieces are fully functional puzzles, and it took me several months to complete. Each piece is based on a 2x2, though I've added some features that makes them more interesting. There's 8 different pawn designs, for example, and the king has an additional assembly element to it. I'll describe it as an obese version of the classic Staunton chess set, though the knight is 100% my design. This is an Egyptian chess set I designed and made back in the last century. 30 or so years later, this is the beginnings of the world's first Twisty Puzzle chess set. It will get better, trust me. I want to transform or mod these 35mm 2x2s into the chess pieces, though at present they are too square. I want the final pieces to be round, so I need to make the 2x2s into barrels in preparation. I could fit round chess pieces over the square 2x2s, but that would result in a huge chess set and a large board. This technique allows for a board with 6cm squares, or even a bit smaller. I've always been amazed that no one else has, to my knowledge, attempted such a chess set. I waited this long personally because my method relies on several things, like good quality small and simple puzzles for the cause, reliable resin that doesn't shrink, a basic knowledge of Google SketchUp, and many years' experience of making puzzles largely by hand. I have no interest in just 3D printing a complete set, but there's many CAD experts who could have done that 10 years ago. It doesn't have to look accurate or nice, just as long as the diameter is not more than this circle, and there's enough flat area to glue the add-ons to. Right, so that's 16 out of the required 32 prepared. Although I'm not using 3D printing for everything, I will still be 3D printing masters, which I can then make moulds from and cast the final pieces in resin. That requires a fair amount of CAD work still. First, I need to design the inner areas of the pieces that will attach to the 2x2s. Now for the actual chess pieces. I thought long and hard about this and eventually settled for a fat version of this standard set. I started with the pawns, and keeping the interior in mind, I created a 2D cross-section. Using SketchUp's Follow Me tool, I then made it round, and for the first time it actually looks like a chess piece. After some more work, it looks like this cut in half. This represents 4 of the cubies, or should I say pawnies perhaps. This represents 2, that will be printed in 3 parts. I can use the bottom 2 parts in the design and making of every chess piece, and I only have to change the tops. This will make things much easier and give the pieces a similar styling. When I come to making the moulds, I will mould the bottom parts individually. The top 2, however, can temporarily be joined together again to make things easier. This will become clearer later. Originally I was going to have all the pawns identical, but that seemed pretty boring. So I've made 8 slightly different designs, which affects the solving. These are the basic diagrams to represent the designs. Obviously the outer shapes are simplified here. The 8 designs are doubled up, since there's obviously a black and white set to be made. Number 1 solves like a regular 2x2. Number 2 has this weird overhanging, which will result in some moves getting blocked, a bit like my Siamese illusion cubes. Number 3 is like number 2, but with more overhanging parts. Number 4 is equivalent to a 2x2 with 2 adjacent corners bandaged. Number 5 contains bandaging and overhanging. Number 6 does the same but in a different way. Number 7 has 2 bandaged pieces and is the easiest to solve. Number 8 again combines bandaging and overhanging and is probably the hardest to solve. These are rough sketches of how some of the parts will actually look. Having decided on so many differences, each of course needs a master for casting, and that means more CAD work. Here I am checking that the overhanging idea will actually work. It does. The CAD files are now uploaded to Shapeways, where I can purchase 3D printed physical versions. Shapeways is situated in Holland and the USA, and as far as I know, it's printed and sent from the nearest one to you. So here are the 3D printed pawn parts. They're obviously going to fit around the 2x2 core. So let's just have a look at them. So you've got the base pieces. So the 2x2 fits in there like that. And then you've got these kind of like middle pieces. And these, of course, will be the same for all the different parts. So I don't need to order any more of these. I can just make molds and cast them. Now for the pawn, I've got these different pieces, and they're going to fit in like that. And these are just two of the what I kind of call the regular pawn pieces. But of course, you've got these different shapes that kind of fit together like that. And they also go into there. So that's pretty much how each pawn is gonna look. I need to make molds of all of these pieces so that I can cast the final chess set in resin. Thing is though, a lot of them are quite thin. And if I put the 2x2 in like that, you can see there's plenty of room around it. So what I'm going to do is fill in some of these areas with Milliput, just to make it a little bit thicker and easier to work with when I come to the mold making and the casting of the pieces. Right, so I've got some mixed up Milliput here, and I'm going to start putting it into here. So that's the first one done. I'm going to let the Milliput go hard, and then I'll like clean up the whole thing, sanding it and making it smooth. So here are some of the parts I'm going to be making molds of. You can see that I've actually temporarily put these two pieces together so they'll be molded as one. And then when I'm making the next pieces, I can separate them and put the new tops on. I'm using this plastic sheet to make little boxes for the molds. This is the same polystyrene that I often use to make actual puzzles. T28 silicon rubber with fast catalyst sets after about 8 hours. I purchased it from Taranti in the UK. You add 5% catalyst to the rubber. I typically leave it mixed up for about 10 minutes or so to release some of the air bubbles, and then pour it from a height to release more. Next day the rubber has set and I can carefully remove the masters. The rubber I use is just the right amount of flexibility. If it's too soft, the molds can distort. If however it's too hard, then it's difficult to remove the masters or the cast pieces later without breaking them. In order to select the rubber with the softness or hardness required, there is a scale for it called the durometer shore hardness scale. This is divided into three different types, though they overlap and the logic behind them is a bit weird. Shore 00 hardness measures rubbers and gels that are very soft. Shore A hardness measures soft to medium rubbers and also includes semi-rigid plastics. Shore D hardness measures hard rubbers and plastics. The rubber I am using here has a Shore A hardness of 28, hence the 28 in the name of it. Some of the masters have come apart, but that's fine since the bottom parts will be reused later for other chess pieces. Everything is looking good and I am pleased so far. Now for the first casting of the actual pawns. I'm using Burson 26, which is a polyurethane resin. It has a natural creamy white colour, which I think is better than making the pieces bright white. Obviously for the black pieces I will need to dye it. Some people use two-part moulds, but that's far more time-consuming, and I avoid it where possible. Leaving an open top, though, results in a slightly bulging side, and it's difficult to get back to the shape it should be. For that reason, I lay more plastic sheet on top, which works pretty well. It does, however, usually trap a few air bubbles, but they can be filled in later. The resin is now solid and I can remove the pieces. I've moulded these into groups of four since I will require 128 in total, and that's a lot of individual resin mixes and castings otherwise. This way is much better. Now for the upper pawn parts. When I use polyester resin, I use little glass squares instead of the plastic sheet for the covers. This is because polyester resin reacts and slightly melts plastic, but easily detaches from the glass. Polyurethane resin, on the other hand, detaches from the plastic but seems to bond tightly to the glass. As I was removing them, however, something was starting to worry me. You see, the 3D printed masters are made from a very tough material, so I never even thought about them breaking. Now I'm working on this resin though, which I have used countless times before, I'm suddenly thinking that they are going to be very fragile. This is always a tricky part of puzzle making. You want things to be strong, but unless you deliberately break them, you can't really know exactly how strong they are. So, now that is really disappointing, and the parts obviously need strengthening somehow. I thought about things like cut down nails, or even the small rods you get left over after pot riveting. In the end though, I settled with paper clips, straightened and cut in half. The white is so they don't show through the resin. Each time I do a casting, I can push the wire into the end and simply cut it off after the part is removed from the mould. I decided to do a test, starting off with another unreinforced piece as a control. Right, so as expected, it broke. Now for the reinforced piece from the same height. Same piece again. And again. And again. The wire seems to work really well, but when I do the larger chess pieces later, there may be some more issues. For example, they may fracture even if they don't fully break. I will look into other stronger resin alternatives if required, but for now we'll carry on with the one I know. Right, so after some more casting of reinforced pieces, I'm ready to do some assembling. This is number one from the eight designs I showed earlier, and is the same as a regular 2x2 in terms of movement. It is, however, a fair bit easier to solve, since there are only two different types of piece. You may be concerned about the colours of the internal 2x2 being visible, and you are not the only one. Unfortunately, I couldn't find a black plastic 2x2 at this size. I did think about painting them white, but from experience that never seems to work. I guess I might think of a way to deal with it later, or maybe just not bother. I really don't know. I will certainly add some kind of material like beige or velour to the underside, but that's something else I'm not bothered with just yet. Mainly because I can't find the right colour at the moment. So let's see how it works. Yes, as a pawn it works fine. Okay, let's test the puzzle. Movement is good and there's no major catches, so I'm pretty pleased. After countless years, I think I'm really on my way to making a Twisty Puzzle chess set. Let's scramble and solve it. With just two differently shaped pieces, it's very easy to solve. You do, however, need to orientate every part, so it's far from trivial. Please remember that the base will be covered, so you won't see those ugly air bubbles. I'm still thinking about the final finish of the pieces. Classic chess sets often have a kind of antique effect, and that would be nice here, instead of the very bland, constant cream colour. These kind of things get decided as I work through the project, and I'll update you later. People often assume that I have everything planned in advance and know what I'm doing. This is seldom the case. I just have three bottom corners to orientate and I will be finished. It's definitely passed the test and I can now start assembling the next two pawn designs. In the first part, I showed how I designed the eight different pawns and went on to cast several pieces and assemble the first one. Here I am showing the other seven, starting off with numbers 2 and 3, which are ready to be assembled. The first two parts are identical to the upper four I used on the first pawn and do not affect the solving of the 2x2. The next one is shorter and doesn't make a difference either. This one though does, since it overhangs a line of rotation, which means it will clash with the first two. The last four pieces are identical and I am using them on every chess piece. As I said in the first episode, I will attach some kind of soft material to the bases so any air bubbles will be covered. A quick check to make sure it looks okay and movement is good. One of the pieces is a slightly different colour because the resin takes a couple of days to go that creamy white. You can see here how the overhang affects movement. This will complicate some algorithms during solving and force them to be modified or avoided. Now onto the third pawn. This has two overhanging pieces with two of the smaller ones sitting beneath the overhangs. A quick check and everything seems fine. These three new pawn pieces arrived today. They are all bandaged and they will enable me to make all eight pawns now. So let's just quickly go through them. The first is what I've labelled as piece G, and this is equivalent to this piece over here, these two pieces, and this piece. So that'll be used in three different pawn designs. Now this pawn piece is a little bit different and I'm labelling it as H. And it's just used in this single pawn over here, pawn number 6. This bandage piece, as you can see, it's got a lot of a cutout bit. And that again is just used in one pawn. And it's used in pawn 8. And it's this piece here. Piece I. Now for some more mould making. You can see I have attached those universal middle pieces. I only have four though, and these bandaged parts require two each, so I can't mould the last pawn part with this mix. So this is the last pawn piece I need to make a mould of, and of course this is one of the pieces I just made a mould from. So I'm now going to take these two pieces off and put it onto there. Now I did lightly glue these pieces together. Right, so I'm going to have to clean these up a little bit and then I'll be gluing them onto the next piece. So it's going to go like that. And like that. So then I can make a mould of it like that. This is a final pawn master and then I will have a full set of moulds. I will however make extra moulds since they can become damaged and wear out. Also it's a good idea to cast different colours in different moulds. An accidental speck of black resin in white resin is something you want to avoid. Taking the master out of the mould and it will be ready to cast some more chess pieces. I'm not using reinforcement wires since these bandaged pieces are much stronger for obvious reasons. The next 5 minutes of a video is the assembly of the remaining five pawns and fairly repetitive. Instead of mindless chatter, I'll play some music. So that's all 8 white pieces complete, apart from the soft material for the bases. I did, however, notice some air bubbles in the sides of the pieces when reviewing the last sequence, so I might fill them in later. For now, though, I'm pretty happy. The final board will be a little bit bigger than this, so they won't look so cramped. Now I'm moving on to the bishops. Since all of my chess pieces have the same lower parts, I have designed it around the cross section of a pawn. I will then remove the lower part where there's an overlap and tidy things up. Now I'm ready to make it round. Here I have dissected it into 4 and I'm checking to make sure it all lines up with the lower pieces. Let's take a look at just the 4 new pieces. At present they are identical, but they won't be when I add the slit that bishops traditionally have. I've made this shape which I will use for the slit. The shape needs to be very precise so the underlying 2x2 can still work. This is part of Google SketchUp that I struggle with, and you can see that the shape was a real mess. It's kind of ironic that I don't have the patience to fully learn the software, but end up wasting hours doing something like this anyway. This is the final design, and once again I have added the bottom parts to see how the whole thing will look. I have positioned the slit very carefully to ensure that the pieces on the left can rotate past those on the right. This will essentially be the same as my number 3 pawn to solve. Obviously the pieces are just variations of simple 2x2s, but I wanted to add a little something to the designs where possible. Here are the pieces that I will upload to Shapeways for 3D printing. Prices are affected by overall space used, so it's best to pack things tightly. It's also affected by the number of separate parts, so I've added tiny joins, meaning its price is a single object. So here are the 3D printed bishop parts. Obviously it's just the top part. I'm going to just break it apart and clean up some of these areas. I've now tidied up all the parts for the bishop, and I will shortly be making the moulds. Now once again I'm going to be using these pieces which I've been using all the way through, and I'll be doing that and then moulding that as a single piece. Once again I'm using T28 silicon rubber, which I get from the UK company Taranti. There are similar silicon rubbers available in other countries, so unless you live in the UK you should look for a more local supplier. An easy way to find something is to search for Smooth On. This company supplies resins and rubbers all over the world, so it should be easy to find a stockist. The rubber has now gone hard, or should I say less soft, and I can remove the masters. There always seems to be some uncured rubber around the outside, so that's why I wear the gloves sometimes. Once out of the boxes though, they aren't required. Here I am tidying up the moulds before I remove the masters. You often get a thin layer of rubber which has crept beneath the master and then needs scraping away with a knife. I don't want loose bits of rubber getting into the resin mixture and casting. I would have liked the two parts to stay together to make another set of moulds. However, I need to separate them later for other pieces, so I could only lightly glue them each time. So it was always likely that they would come unstuck during this process. Now to insert the paperclip wire reinforcement and it will be ready for casting pieces. It's always a good idea to have some spare mould sitting around in case you mix up a bit too much. That's far better than not mixing enough. If that happens, you end up panicking and frantically mixing another batch. This polyurethane resin takes about 5 minutes to start setting, so you don't have much time. Although the setting starts in about 5 minutes, it remains very fragile for much longer, so I always wait an hour or so before removing them. Plastic sheet is added to the tops to ensure flat sides, though it does create air bubbles which will need filling. The resin is now set and I can remove the bishop parts from the moulds. The wires need trimming and the parts tidying up. Same routine as before. A little super glue on some glass so it doesn't soak in and remains liquid for a while. Then a needle is used to accurately place the glue. Some of these parts needed to be sanded to make sure they fitted correctly. This is because the process of moulding and casting carries some minor inaccuracies. The rubber mould, for example, can bulge slightly, though not enough to notice during any individual stage. Movement is nice and smooth. So yeah, I think that's looking good. Obviously I can now demonstrate the blocking side of it, so that's the sort of thing you're gonna run into when you're trying to solve it. And I will just mix it up and solve it now. Right. So I'll go for the top. That's wrong. Okay. So it's three top pieces done and just put in the last one. Right, so now just the bottom, I can see three pieces need to be correctly orientated. Almost done. Right, solved. So, I mean, that sort of blocking side of it really isn't going to cause a lot of issues, but I just thought it'd be nice to kind of include it. And obviously, bishops come in pairs. Tony's log supplemental. That's a Star Trek reference, by the way, if you didn't get it. I've already said that I've been using Dispersion 26 resin, which I've been using for years and years and years. It's really great when you're like making black pieces for things like golden cube or whatever. I've never had any real issues with it. Now I'm working on this, I'm finding some issues. I've already said about it being not that strong and I'm having to reinforce the pieces. But something I've noticed as well is, I think I mentioned that the colouring has been a bit different, and I assume that was because it takes a couple of days to go from that colour to that colour. But now it's been more than a couple of days, and I've looked at some of my other pieces, and there is a definite variation in colour. Now, I did change the tins a little while ago. Like, I obviously used up the old tins, and I went on to these two new ones. And I think it's pretty obvious that the new ones are a slightly different colour. Now, I believe this resin is being discontinued, or certainly not being sold anymore by Taranti, where I buy my materials from. So I think there may have been an issue with it. So I'm a little bit disappointed with that. So what I'm going to do, I'm not going to start all over again, but I think I will continue making the set and finish it off. And then like a lot of my projects, I'll kind of have a like an initial puzzle or whatever that's okay, kind of like a prototype that I know that I'll never sell because it's not good enough to sell, and that's kind of the one I keep forever. But then, if I come to make more puzzles or chess sets or whatever you want to call them, then I'll be like doing them in a better quality, using a better material. So, in a future video, I will be looking at other materials and seeing what else I could possibly use instead of Burson 26. But so it's kind of like a little bit of a setback. The colour is not too bad; it's okay. But I mean, these things happen when you work on projects. Now I'm moving on to the rooks. As with all the chess pieces, I'm using the same bottom parts and just making new tops. Here you can see a cross section of the two together. I remove the bottom part and make the top round with SketchUp's Follow Me tool. If I put back the bottom parts in their 3D form, you can get a rough idea of how the rook will look. I've also dissected the top into four parts. Here are the positions of the turrets, which obviously I couldn't do before using the Follow Me tool. There are two unique designs out of the four, and each one is doubled up opposite each other. This means a little thought will be required when solving the rooks, though obviously, like all the other pieces, it's just a 2x2. This is a final design, and you can more easily see what I meant about the turrets. Removing a part shows how I have made it hollow yet still 3D printable. The cast pieces are obviously solid, as I've shown in my previous episodes. Here are the new 3D printed parts for the rook. As you can see, there's just two, because each one is doubled up. So I'm just going to snap them apart, and I'm going to tidy up these areas. Where are we? Yeah. The rook pieces are now cleaned up and ready for moulding. However, as before with the other pieces, I'll need to put this kind of like a universal piece there. And then of course, when I cast the pieces, it'll go out to the 2x2. And we'll have the same kind of universal bottoms as well. So it's gonna kind of look something like that. T28 silicon rubber being poured into the polystyrene boxes contained in the Shapeways 3D printed masters. Since the rooks require two of each, I will need to use these molds several times. Alternatively, I might make some more molds later. The rubber is very expensive, so it's important to work out exactly in advance how much you will require. Next day, the rubber is set and I can remove it from the boxes. I always clean up the polystyrene sheet so it can be used again later for other molds. After a quick tidy up to remove any loose bits of rubber, I can now remove the masters. Everything is looking good at this stage. There's no noticeable air bubble, so the casting of the resin pieces should go well, providing I can get the resin into all the turrety areas. Burson 26 polyurethane resin. Plastic sheet onto the tops to make sure the sides are flat, though it also creates air bubbles which will need filling. Some people use a vacuum to degas the resin, but it's a bit complicated and you only have about 4 minutes before it starts to set. The resin has fully set, so I can remove it from the moulds. Not bad, but there are several air bubbles around those turrets which I will have to fill. Here's another casting, uncut but speeded up. It gives a better idea of the whole process. See how I'm using thin wire to push into the corners and also tip up the moulds. This helps reduce air bubbles, though I still get more than I hoped for. When I make extra moulds, I might do them a bit different, so the turrets are at the bottom. This would ensure that the resin goes into those areas that might cause air bubbles to form at the other end. It's really a case of experimenting and seeing what works best. The pieces have been tidied and can now be attached to the 2x2 core. I'm starting with the top pieces and using Loctite super glue. This sticks really well, too well in fact sometimes, because if you make an error and want to reposition a piece, it's usually impossible. In the past, I've had to use a saw and Dremel to remove incorrectly glued pieces, which is a massive pain. During my time making these parts, I was also looking into other resins and dyes to get the best colours for the black and white chess pieces. Puzzle making is seldom a linear activity for me. I'm constantly thinking about ways to improve things. Often by the end of a project, I've found so many ways of improving everything, I literally start again from scratch. The four tops have gone on well and I only have the bottoms to attach. These will of course be covered by some kind of material later. Right, so I finished the rooks. I think they're okay. Not fantastic, but okay. You see a bit of a gap here, which isn't great. And of course, we've got the ongoing issue of the two colours. As I've said before, that's because it's from a different batch of resin. It's the same type of resin, so it should be the same. I did these earlier, and I just don't want to like throw them away. So I'm kind of thinking of this as a prototype. So when everything is done and I'm kind of happy with the moulds and everything, then I will go back and make a proper set. But for now, I'm just going to keep going. Right, so just to explain the design again. This piece and this piece is identical, and that piece is identical. So they're kind of like mirror images, like that. So we just mix it up. Get things aligned properly. Nothing is clashing, so I'm kind of happy with that movement. So now let's go for a solve. Start with the top. And you see those two pieces have just kind of gone together, but they're actually wrong because the spacing of the turrets is wrong. But that piece though is right. So those two pieces are right. So that piece needs to go in there. So we've got three, and then take that out, put it in the right way around. So you can see now how the spacing of the turrets is correct. Just bottoms to be orientated. And we're done. So yeah, I think it's okay. But as I say, I'm going to go back and do everything again later.
I'm now ready to do the queen. I will use the same lower parts as on the others, so once again I have only the top four pieces to design. Here's a basic shape. I can now use Google SketchUp's follow me tool to make it round. That was the easy part, now comes the difficult bit. The crown needs some additional shaping, similar to the turrets on my rooks. I'm sure there's an easy way to do this, but it took me several hours work and a lot of hair pulling. I wanted each of the queen's top four parts to be unique, instead of the two unique parts on the rooks, which were then doubled up. This was achieved in the way I designed the crown. It has nine little turrety things, which is a good number when spaced over the four parts, to get the uniqueness desired. This means each top layer cubie, or queenie, must be correctly positioned when solving the puzzle. Obviously that's easy, but the crown is very small and it won't be so easy to see what goes where. The aim is basically to annoy solvers and give the piece its own character. Once a crown is done, it's just a case of splitting the piece into four, giving them a thickness, and then getting the parts 3D printed at Shapeways. These are the new 3D printed parts for the queen. As with the others, I'm going to take it apart from the way it was 3D printed and I'm going to tidy up all these little kind of pieces of flashing.
Now for the mould making. I've glued the masters onto the bottom of these custom made polystyrene boxes and I am pouring T28 silicon rubber over them. I'm using the fast T5 catalyst.
The rubber has set and I can remove the masters. Since I'm concerned about the strength of some pieces, like the narrow queen, even with the wire reinforcement, I purchased some different resin to experiment with. This is a flexible and very strong, smooth-on 65D. It's by far the strongest resin I've ever tried, and may be something I could use after I finish the prototype set. For now though, it's back to the Burson 26, despite the issues with the colour variation. The resin is set, so ready for demoulding. After a quick tidy up, I can glue them onto the cut down 2x2. So that's the queen done. I'm a little bit worried about these gaps. I mean, they're kind of okay, but I suppose with these long extensions, it's difficult to get it absolutely lined up perfectly. Actually, on the queen, it's not going to be a huge issue, but when I come to do the king later, you'll see that it might be an issue. So let's mix up the thing. Just first though, I'm going to say a little bit more about this design, because each of the four top parts are different, and they're only subtly different, which you can see sort of on the crown. So that's kind of deliberately annoying, because I think when people come to solve it, they're going to kind of think it's solved, and then they're going to look at it closely, look at that crown closely, and realise that it doesn't look quite right. So that kind of annoyance is intentional, because I do like to annoy people. This is quite weird of all these bits sticking out like this. It's sort of something I haven't really experienced before with a puzzle. I don't like the way I can see so much of the inside, but I guess it's gonna be the same for all of these. Right, so that's pretty thoroughly mixed up. So let's go for a solve. Now I do remember from the way I've designed it, the crown with the two little bits, whatever you want to call them, goes opposite the one of the three sort of biggest ones. So I know for a fact that those two are now correct. So it's going to be a case of filling in the other pieces, which, well, there's only two options, so let's try them. Yeah, I think that's right. Just put in the other one to check. Yeah, that's right, because the pieces are all sort of spaced well. Right, so let's just do the bottom. So we've got one corner is rotated correctly, and the other one needs, orientating. Oh, kind of messed that up, but never mind. Just need orientating. Right, so another piece made and another piece solved. Now I'm making the king, which will look like this. It will still be a 2x2, of course, but since it's a king, I decided to add a special non-twisty element, which will become clearer later. So let's see how I got there. As with all of the others, I'm using the same bottom parts and just making a new top. Here you can see half a cross section of the two together. Notice how there's no cross at this stage. If I get rid of the bottom, you can see what I did next. I used SketchUp's Follow Me tool and made it round, though only through 90 degrees. Obviously, there will be four of these, and they will go together like this. The hole in the top is where the non-twisty element will go, so each one needs some further work. This is the cross part which will fit into that hole. With these modifications to the four pieces, it can only be inserted in one way. In addition, you must decide where the four pieces go in relation to each other when solving the base 2x2 puzzle. Simply putting them all at the top isn't enough. With the design finished, it's now a case of packing the pieces as closely as possible together and uploading the file to Shapeways, who will 3D print the masters for me. Then I can make moulds and cast the pieces. The 3D printed king parts have now arrived from Shapeways. Let's break the pieces apart. So I'm just going to tidy up the parts and remove these joining pieces. After attaching the universal middle pieces, I can now make the moulds. T28 silicon rubber from UK company Tranti is poured into little boxes made from polystyrene sheet. I'm using a T5 fast catalyst, which makes the rubber set faster. I will leave it overnight in a warm place and it will be ready in the morning. The rubber has now set and I can remove it from the boxes before taking the masters out of the moulds. I'm tidying up the moulds and removing any loose rubber that will affect the casting later. Four out of the five moulds look good so far, but this one is a reject. I think the master had come a bit loose, so there was too much rubber sort of went over it, so it's just not going to be any good. Right, so that one's looking good as well. And the third one. This is where things get a little bit complicated, because this shape is quite weird. It's kind of got lots of cuts and stuff. So what you tend to do, you attempt to take it out by loosening it up. But you kind of know that it's probably not going to come out like that. Now, I believe cutting it makes it technically a split mould, but I'd have to check that. By doing it this way, it won't affect the moulding later, sorry, the casting later, but it will allow the pieces to come out. Well, that kind of looks a bit complicated in there. To be honest with you, I'm not that confident about this. It looks a bit messy, but I'm going to keep going. But if it doesn't work, then I'm basically learning from the way I'm doing it. So then if I may have to make another mould and I cut it again, the next time I'll cut it better and it will work. That feels good. That thing is coming out now. Right, so we've got the shape out. So just a reminder of how kind of complicated this shape is and why it didn't want to come out of the mould. Right, now for the casting. Once again, I'm using wire from white paper clips as a reinforcement, since the parts will be thin and fragile. This is a mould for the cross part. I need to make sure the resin goes into every corner, so that's why I'm holding it like this. Poking a wire in also helps. I'm sure the experts use complicated vents, but I can't be bothered with all that. An elastic band to hold it together, and it's done, hopefully. The resin has now gone hard, and I'm ready to take the castings out of the moulds. And obviously one of these big ones is missing because I need to redo the rubber. but I'll come back to that later. So let's see how these king pieces look. Just going to tidy up around them. I don't want all this sort of loose stuff getting inside the moulds for the next casting. Right, so now I can demold. So that's come out pretty good. Needs to be tidied up a bit. So I'll take out the other parts and then sort of see how they all fit together. I will just jump onto this one because this is the one that might well not work. And if it doesn't work, I'll have to do it in a mold it in a different way or cut it in a different way. I just kind of feel as though this one might be a complete nightmare because the shape is just really awkward. The plastic isn't going to be as strong as the 3D printed material, so I have to be a lot more careful taking it out of this than I did earlier. Oh, well, actually, that's not too bad. Actually, that's brilliant. I was expecting a load of air bubbles. Got a little tiny air bubble underneath the cross, but that can easily be filled up. So, yeah, I'm very pleased with that. And because that will eventually fit kind of in there, like that, when everything's sort of tidied up and cleaned. So, yeah, that's pretty good. Earlier I showed this mould of a king piece that didn't come out very well. I've now since replaced it and I think that's looking a lot better. So let's remove the master. Yes, that's fine, and I was able to cast the final king piece, which you can see here alongside the others. Now for assembly. I'm starting with the four bottom parts, which are identical on every chess piece. A needle dipped into super glue is the best way to apply it to small areas. Now for the tops. It's very important that these are attached accurately, or the final cross part won't fit into the puzzle. That's why I am using a ruler as a set square. In theory, there should only be one way to attach the parts, but you always get inaccuracies creeping in during mould making and casting. My biggest concern is that these parts will lean away from each other slightly. However, once two are attached and sit almost touching, you know they are going to be okay. Third piece looking good. Fourth piece, and hopefully the cross can then be inserted without any issues. So that's the king now assembled and finished. Just a quick look at it. I think it looks okay. There is a bump there that I'm not too happy about, but I was really concerned about like getting these four pieces really tightly together. Otherwise, the cross wouldn't really work very well. But basically, that's just my inaccuracy, that there's a bump there. So I just want to go through the design again. So to remove the cross, you turn it anti-clockwise, lift it, anti-clockwise, lift it. So when you're solving, you obviously have to get those four pieces in the right position, because round the outside, they look identical. So the solver wouldn't necessarily know where they go in relation to each other. I will just scramble it and solve it to sort of show you that thing further. It also gives me a chance to check whether there's any sort of clashing going on, and I think it's okay. Right, now I'm going to start with the highest piece, and obviously as a designer I know how this goes. So the next highest piece goes to there, and then that piece goes into there, and then obviously the last piece goes into the last place. Right, so if you're solving this for the first time, you would now want to check whether the cross goes into it. So, to there, twist, down, twist. Now, it has the final twist because if it just, I mean, it looks okay like that. But then if you're playing chess and using it, it's gonna be loose. So I put the final twist in that goes like that to hold it into place. So you can just pick up the piece there if you wanted to. Now obviously that blocks movements. You still got that movement, but not the other movement. So you'd need to take that out and then solve the bottom, which of course is dead simple 2x2 corners. Like that, and now you can put in the top again, lock it into place, and there's the finished king.
In my previous episodes, I made all the different pieces required for my Twisty Puzzle chess set, except the knights. I left these to the end because I knew they would be really hard to make. Having completed all the other pieces though, I was hugely motivated to finish the set, or I would have wasted hours of work and a lot of money. So giving up because the knights were too hard simply wasn't an option. But how should I proceed? From my experience, you go with what you already have and know and let things develop naturally. For example, since the chess pieces all have the same lower area, that's half the design done already. I can go ahead and make that and only have the top to worry about. The top half is a horse, so let's take a look at some photos of horses and knights from existing chess sets. I wanted to sculpt the horse by hand, but was happy to help the process along as much as possible. So let's put this horse onto the bottom and see how it looks. Not bad. Even if I can sculpt it though, there's going to be an issue with cutting it into four so it can attach to the 2x2 core and work as a puzzle. So let's make a silhouette, divide it into four, and add some joining areas that will fit onto the lower parts. Then I can use plasticine to make the four-part sculpture. To be honest, I rushed into printing this and should have given it some more thought, since later I changed my mind and went for this design, which enables me to have a bishop overhang type movement. So the head would be entirely on the left two cubies and will overhang the throat and chest on the right two. This will make it easier to sculpt, though I need to modify those 3D printed parts. I reshaped them with a Dremel and had to do some cutting and gluing. It looks a complete mess, but trust me, I know what I am doing. Well, kind of. So to clarify, it's an approximate guide for the sculpting. It's a solid structure to hold the plasticine. Plus it means after the sculpting I'll have four separate parts I can make moulds of, instead of having to cut the horse into four by hand, which would be really hard to do accurately and without damaging it. I'm going to sculpt the shape in a high quality plasticine that is suitable for making rubber moulds from. I suspect any plasticine would be fine, but if I am wrong, the time spent sculpting will have been wasted. I've already changed my mind once on the design, and as I started to sculpt, I changed it again. I liked the dissection plan, but felt an urge to make it a genuine horse shape, not the cartoony representation you get in most chess sets. Doing that seemed like a cop-out and way too easy. With the other pieces done by CAD and Masters 3D printed by Shapeways, I wanted the knights to be more personal. A reflection of what I can do by hand and not on computer. Something genuine and honest. Having made that decision though, I was faced with delivering it. An experienced sculptor has the right tools and knows the correct way to go about things like this. For me though, it would be many hours trying to get the shape correct with a screwdriver, pencil and piece of plastic. It was very much two steps forward and one step back. All the time I was learning what a horse really looks like. There's not much difference between a horse's head and a greyhound's, or even a Tyrannosaurus Rex. Fine perhaps for a dog or dinosaur themed chess set, but not like the one I was making.
process to make this one part took around 3 hours. I was thinking about uploading an unedited version, and perhaps I still will. However, it would be mind-numbingly boring, with long periods where I wasn't advancing at all. Just going over the same areas again and again. You actually reach a point where you can no longer make an objective judgment. Are the eyes too small, or maybe in the wrong place? Same with the ears, it's hard to say. At some point you have to decide it's done and won't get better. Will people love it, hate it, or be indifferent? I really have no idea. Is it good enough for me? Then yes. Well, I guess. Or maybe I just mean it won't get better, so it'll have to do. Either way, you have to stop sometime. And now I'm stopping. As with all the other masters, the piece is fixed to the bottom of a plastic box, ready for mould making. It's then covered in T28 silicon rubber mixed with the T5 fast catalyst. The rubber is now set and I can remove the master. Some of the plasticine has been left in the mould, but it's easy to remove. Because the plasticine master is soft and easily damaged, the first casting will be to create a second generation master. I'm using Smooth On Task 2 for this, since it's very strong and I had some left over from my previous experiments to find a better resin. I will be making second generation masters for all four top pieces of the night. I will then tidy them up and make new moulds and cast the parts for the actual chess pieces. The resin is now hard and ready to remove. It's okay, but the end of the ear is missing where an air bubble must have formed. I'll fill it with some milliput and it should be fine. I now need a mirror image of it also. Unfortunately, in the real world, I can't simply copy, paste and flip to make it. First, I need to modify the 3D printed frame in a similar fashion to before. So now for the sculpting. I can use this reflection to help me, though a lot of it will be done with the parts temporarily assembled. I'm so glad I devised this technique, since it makes things so much easier than they could have been. Imagine sculpting the horse's head and then cutting it accurately into four without doing any damage to it. That's how I initially thought I would have to do it. Let's have some music while I do this work, and then I'll talk some more later. The music was The Future Ancient Now by Nathan Moore. Sculpting the other side of the head took about half the time of the first. It's now finished and I can carefully remove it. The eyes, by the way, are leftover school ball bearings from my old projects. A little tidying up was required, but I can add the universal middle and make a mould and silicon rubber. Once set, the sculpture is removed and I can use the mould to cast the second generation master in smooth-on Task 2 polyurethane resin. This of course is much more durable than the plasticine, plus I can sand it to make it smoother. I'm poking wire into the ears because this is where air bubbles formed in the other side's castings. The resin is now set and ready to be removed. See how the ear is okay, whereas the first half had a bit missing where an air bubble got trapped. I'm using wet and dry sandpaper to make it smoother before using the part to make the final mould. My design means the throat and chest of the horse are very simple and easy to sculpt. I still need to make moulds of the two parts of Kuss and cast second generation masters. The rubber is set so the parts can be removed. Now for the smooth-on Task 2 polyurethane resin. Plastic sheet on the top to make sure it remains perfectly flat and the right dimensions. The resin is set and ready to be removed. After some sanding, a quick check to see everything lines up correctly. Before I make the final set of night moulds, I need to repair the ear of the first piece I cast. I'm using Milliput, which is a two-part epoxy putty that sets like resin, though not as hard. Once set, I can sand it to make it smoother. With all four parts of the night's top done, I'm ready to make the final moulds for casting the actual chess pieces. As you have probably realised by now, this puzzle making technique involves an awful amount of mould making and casting. I still find it far more satisfying than just 3D printing everything though. The rubber has set so I can remove the second generation masters. Now for the casting with the Burson 26 polyurethane resin. Resin is set and ready for removal. The parts look fine, though we'll need some minor tidying up and filling before they are attached onto the 2x2 core. As usual, I am using Loctite superglue gel. I've squeezed some onto a piece of glass and using a needle to accurately place it where needed. As with the King, the placement of the parts onto the 2x2 must be perfect. A horse that doesn't line up with itself would look awful, whereas a pawn, for example, isn't quite as important. I am unhappy about leaving the bright colours on the 2x2 as they would be visible during some moves. However, I have never managed to dye this kind of plastic, and painting just makes a puzzle this size stiff. So I have no option but to just leave it. Some more casting and assembly, and I have both white knights finished. Now for a test and a solve. Movement seems okay, there's no clashing. And it's important that I got the pieces like very close together, otherwise it's going to just look wrong with a big gap. And there's always a danger, because when you do that, or when you sort of make those moves, it's going to like hit each other. Let's just scramble it. kind of weird seeing it like that. Obviously these pieces will be covered up with the material. Let's see if there's any other sort of weird kind of way I can make it. Okay. Right, so let's go for a solve. Although actually just before I do that, I'll just show you the like the obvious blocking type situation, which is the same on some of the pawns and also the bishop. Right, enough of that, and just put those pieces together. Because these pieces are very similar, so they're not, it's not obvious where they go, although I know actually that curved piece goes there. But if you're solving it for the first time, or you don't, if you don't know the puzzle, you wouldn't know that. So that's the top part done, and just two of the corners need orientating. It's a little awkward with the pieces sticking out. See, that's when you get an issue, because I can't complete the move how I wanted it to. And now I've kind of completely lost where I was. Maybe I'll go around the other way. I think we'd have to start again. I'm just going to see what happens if I put this bottom into place. You never know, it might sort of come up nice. Now things are getting a bit weird. Now I've kind of got to start again. I think out of all of these I've tried so far, that's the first time I've actually kind of got on a muddle with something. Because obviously they're only 2x2, so they're pretty easy, but that completely threw me off. So let's try this again. So I've got to orientate that piece and orientate that piece. Trying to keep track of where I am in case that same thing happens again. Right, so I think I'm going to be okay this time. These aren't clashing, it's just that it's awkward to hold. That's if it looks as if it's kind of a bit weird. Right, so that's solved. A little bit trickier than I expected, but at least it shows us sort of the clashing element works.
With a full set of white pieces done, you maybe expect me to crack open a champagne. If you've watched every video though, you will understand why I am not. In the next video, I will rectify every issue with these pieces and present a Twisty Puzzle chess set I can truly be proud of. Well, hopefully. I'd previously been using Burson 26, which is fine when you add black dye to it and then cast pieces and put stickers on. But when you just do it like natural without any dye, I was getting these two different colours. And also I discovered that the site I was getting this from aren't doing it anymore. So I thought, right, that's Burson 26 finished. I can't use it anymore. In a previous video, I think it was my Queen video, I experimented with this smooth cast 65D. And this is very flexible and very strong.
However, it takes about 2 minutes before it starts going off. So if you're doing lots of molds, that makes it really difficult. So I turn to smooth on task three. Now this takes 20 minutes to go off, so I thought that would be a lot better. And I know it's also pretty strong. And as you can see, I kind of gambled on buying quite a lot of it. Now the issue with that though, is when you start adding dye, you get these little tiny air bubbles appearing. If I didn't add any dye, I didn't get any issues. So for some reason, the dye is affecting the way it's coming out. Now I contacted a company and they were just completely useless, but basically I can't use this for the chess set. I thought again about Burson 26, which I pretty much turned my back on. And I looked around the internet and found another company that was selling it. And then I discovered that it's not being discontinued. And I contacted this company and asked whether there was any issues with the coloration. And they said there wasn't. So I thought, right, I'm gonna buy a big load of it, like 5 kilos or whatever this is. Even if there's issues with different colors, at least it's all gonna be one color. Whereas when I'm buying tins like this, you know, I finish those tins and then I go on to another set and they could be a different colour. So I'm back to Burson G26 and I'm casting a whole set of pieces from this resin. I will completely redo the white set, but first I want to make the black. Here I am using the same dye that I purchased from Smooth On. Luckily it works fine with the Burson 26, far better than Smooth On's own resin. However, there are still some issues, just in case I hadn't had enough issues already. In order to guarantee a consistent colour across the pieces, I'm adding dye to just one of the resin components. I can then mix small amounts with the other component to cast the pieces. I'm aiming for a kind of dark reddish brown, but this technique means the colour you see here will be diluted on the final chess piece. So I have to go for a much darker colour than I want, and it's very nearly black. You also have to take into account that the raw resin colour is cream, and that will affect the colour mix. This all means it's incredibly hard to get the exact colour you want, and I'll have to settle with anything close. So I'm straight into a massive casting session. The Burson 26 takes about 4 minutes to set, so I'm mixing it in small batches. You can see how I have set up the plastic cups in preparation. Although I now have spares for many moulds, I will still need to do extra casting to get the complete set of black pieces. The resin is now set so I can remove the flat pieces of plastic. I will fill any visible air bubble holes with more resin before I take them out of the rubber molds. Since my video about the king, I've altered the way I do the cross. I avoid two-part molds where possible, but this complex little shape requires it. I have filled in the air bubbles, the resin has set so I can remove the pieces from the molds. I won't bore you with every one, but here's a quick look at the knight. After a few days, I had enough parts to make the black pieces. There's also a few spares here, which will go towards making additional chess sets later. For those who haven't seen my previous videos, a quick recap of the process. I first took 16 35mm mass-produced 2x2s. I then cut them down into rough barrel shapes. And I then glued on the cast parts. The process is then obviously repeated for the new white pieces, which will replace the ones with the colour issues. See my previous videos for the full moulding and casting process. Now I need to add soft pads to the bases. I'm using a material that is soft on one side and kind of shiny and leathery on the other. The shiny side makes it easy to glue. Normal chess pieces have a single large base, which is seldom seen. So you can just use a dollop of Evo stick and some green felt pads. That's not suitable for my Twisty Puzzle chess set though, because the bases are in four parts, plus they will be visible when scrambled. So all the pieces are now finished, and I am pretty happy with this. You may be thinking that this chessboard is a little bit cramped, and you'd be right, because this board wasn't made for these pieces. So I'm going to be making a slightly bigger board out of this plastic sheet. This is the white is left over from making the stickers for my 2 meter world record Rubik's Cube. And the black is just from like projects from years ago. When I've cut all the squares, I will be attaching it to this slightly thicker sheet. What I'll do, I'll do the board in two parts, so it'll be kind of similar to this one. And then I'll put a basic hinge down the middle so it can fold into two pieces. The easiest way to cut plastic sheet into identical squares is to score a grid with a straight-bladed craft knife and then snap the squares apart. This, however, causes tiny burrs along the edges, which need removing with a curved blade. I thought about making some kind of fancy board and box, which were puzzles themselves, but it felt like a distraction and it would just add even more time and expense to the project. There's nothing stopping me doing that later, I guess, but for now I just want the set finished. I'm using plastic weld to attach the squares. Unlike glue, it slightly dissolves the plastic to form a perfect bond. In theory, the board should be perfectly smooth and flat now, but in reality, you get slight variations and a few areas where the plastic weld has splashed onto the surface. For these reasons, I am using wet and dry sandpaper. First, I am using 240 grit, and then I'll be using 600. The water stops the paper from clogging, making it easier to use and prolonging its life. Both halves are now finished, so it's time to make a hinge. I considered various options, but nothing seemed better to me than plain and simple gaffer tape. Using anything else is going to add unwanted thickness to this area. I haven't checked how professionally made boards are done, but it must be pretty similar. I'm signing and numbering the board because this set is going to Roxanne and George Miller's Puzzle Palace Museum. Usually when I make puzzles, I keep the first ones for myself. But I think it's more important that the museum gets the world's first Twisty Puzzle Chess Set, and I can make the next one for myself. So here is the completed chess set and board. It's far from perfect, especially if you closely inspect the pieces in person, but on the whole, I'm pretty happy with it. As well as these 9 construction videos, there's also a basic demo and solve of the more interesting pieces.